All right, we're going to go ahead and go through some vocabulary that will be helpful to you as we talk about the research paper that you're going to be writing. We're going to start with some words that have more to do with argument and with writing, and then later on we'll talk about sources and citations. So let's start with the word argument. Contrary to our society's popular belief, you do not have to be angry, you do not have to be mean-spirited in order to engage in argument. An argument, in general, is just an exchange of a diverging or opposing views. So when two people have two different opinions and they discuss it. When we're talking about argument within writing, it's when you have a set of reasons given with the aim of persuading others that an action or idea is right or wrong. Now, I know you're taking notes at home, you should be taking notes on these words. I would just write down what's in bold: a set of reasons and the aim is of persuading others. That's what an argument is, especially as we're talking about it in writing. Part of an argument is making claims. A claim is when you maintain that something is true. It's a statement. Okay, claims support and are generally a part of your overall argument. A claim is stated clearly, and in your research paper that you're going to be writing, your claims are going to be your topic sentences. Okay, so for example, if your thesis is there are many benefits to having students wear uniforms in school and they should be enforced nationwide. Sorry, there should be a D there. Okay, so uniforms, good. That's your kind of overall overarching argument. One claim within that argument would be that school uniforms foster an environment of learning. And then of course you'd have to discuss that, but that's a claim. Okay, that ultimately supports your argument of uniforms are a good, positive thing that should be enforced nationwide. A second claim could be school uniforms reduce gang violence during the day, during the school day. And some of you guys at home might be laughing like, that sounds ridiculous. Like, uniforms reduce gang violence? Come on, Mrs. Lee. You're just messing with me. But it's actually true. There's studies that suggest that. So that would be an interesting research assignment too, to research what are the benefits of uniforms, because most students generally don't like them, but that doesn't mean there's not value in them, right? Third claim, students have a more positive self-image when wearing uniforms. Again, research actually suggests that, so that would be a claim underneath my overall argument, okay? You should check it out if you haven't. An opinion is different than a claim. An opinion is a belief, even if it's held with confidence, that is not substantiated by positive knowledge or proof, okay? An opinion is, I don't like uniforms. Okay, thanks, but that really doesn't actually help either side of the argument just because you don't like them, right? Or I like uniforms. If I were to go back to this overall argument of there are many benefits, if you were to say for one of your claims that I really like uniforms, that would be an opinion, not a claim. It's not something that you could back up with proof. Like, your only proof is you like them, okay? So that would be an opinion, much, much different than a claim, which you can actually back up with proof. An opponent is someone who opposes, obviously, or disagrees with your argument, okay? So it's the person on the other side. You say that that uniforms are beneficial. Your opponent would say, no, uniforms are not beneficial. When building an argument, especially a written one, you should always think about what would the opponent say, okay? How would my opponent respond to what I'm saying right now? Because you will have to deal with counterclaims, okay? You want to think about what your opponent would say, because a counterclaim is the claim that your opponent would argue. And you're going to have to include counterclaims in your writing. Okay, it's always good to acknowledge that the other side exists. It's always good to acknowledge that the other side has valid points too. Okay, so a counterclaim is a claim that disagrees or goes against your stance. And again, if you're taking notes at home, make sure you're just writing in the bold. Okay, so it disagrees or goes against your stance. So for example, a counterclaim to my uniforms are a positive thing argument is those who oppose school uniforms might argue that they diminish a student's individuality or freedom of expression. Okay. Now, a couple things to note on this. First of all, I'm identifying that this isn't my reason. Okay. That this doesn't have to do with my argument. I said those who oppose school uniforms. Okay, so I acknowledged that there's an opponent speaking here, or that I'm acknowledging the opponent. I'm not necessarily, like, I don't just say school uniforms are beneficial, and then all of a sudden I say, well, they might diminish a student's individuality or freedom of expression. No, I say students are beneficial. There are some people who would say that they diminish a student's individuality or freedom of expression, But again, I'm acknowledging that other people are the ones that say that. Okay? If you have a counterclaim, you must refute that counterclaim, okay? Or you must have a refutation, all right? And this is actually even more important than the counterclaim. The counterclaim acknowledges that somebody else is out there and they might disagree with me. The refutation is where you bring it home. You say, okay, they disagree with me. This is what they say, but here's why they're wrong, okay? So a refutation, or to refute something, is to provide evidence that proves an opinion or argument to be incorrect. Okay, that's what you want to do to the opposing side's argument in a debate or in a paper. Okay, in a verbal debate, being able to prepare a refutation or rebuttal is the main reason that you do want to think about what your opponent's potential counterclaims would be. Right? As you're building your argument, you want to be thinking, what would my opponent say? Because then you're going to have to respond to what your opponent would say. Okay, and you do this in writing too, right? You give your reason. You say, I think uniforms are beneficial because this, 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 and this. Other people say this, but here's why they're wrong. The here's why they're wrong part is the refutation. And again, that's why you consider the opponent's argument or the counterclaim. So for example, down at the bottom, I have my counterclaim, not in bold, and then my refutation in bold. So let's look. Those who oppose school uniforms might argue that they diminish a student's individuality or freedom of expression. However, studies have shown that students actually have a more positive self-image when uniforms are required. Now, one thing I want to point out about this refutation is that it directly responds to the idea in the counterclaim. So you can't just be like, oh yeah, those who oppose school uniforms might argue that they diminish a student's individuality or freedom of expression. However, uniforms are much cheaper. Like, see how cheaper and like the cost of uniforms, it doesn't really respond to the idea of individuality or freedom of expression. So that doesn't work as a refutation. Notice my refutation here in bold specifically responds to the idea of individuality. Okay, it has to do with a person's self-image. It has to do with the person's sense of self. And that's why I use the refutation of having a more positive self-image when uniforms are required. Okay? Thesis statement. Gosh, I hope by now you guys know what a thesis statement is, but still, I'd make sure that we do here. So a thesis statement is a single sentence that clearly states the author's stance in an argument. Okay. And your thesis statement might include a brief overview of the claims or reasons, but the main point of your thesis in an argumentative research paper is to state your stance. Okay. How do you feel about this topic? All right. Support. Okay. To furnish support or to provide support is to provide evidence for a particular belief or conclusion. Okay. You must support your claims with evidence from scholarly sources. Okay. Without support, your argument lacks support. It doesn't have much. Okay. Context. This is really important. This is important in the writing of it more than anything. Okay. Context is the information about where evidence comes from and why it is trustworthy. Okay. This information will help you lead into your concrete detail or example. Okay. So for example, you can see all that in bold is context, right? I have this quote and I'm talking about cancer research, let's just say. So I got to give context for why this evidence is trustworthy. I got to tell you why this piece of evidence is worthwhile to listen to. Okay. So here my example is Dr. Melly Medina, a leading researcher at the UCLA Medical Center, wrote an investigative case study entitled The Problem with Cancer Research. In her study, she asserts, all of that is context leading up to the quote. By the time I get to the quote, I'm confident because I know that it's Dr. Melly Medina who said it, who's a leading researcher at the UCLA Medical Center, right? If I'm researching something about, cancer research, I want to make sure that the information is good, especially with something scientific like that, right? A concrete detail, and I kind of mentioned this on the last slide, but the concrete detail is your example. Okay, it's an example that supports your claim. This is your evidence. A concrete detail might be a quote. It might be a paraphrase. But this is your specific piece of evidence that comes from an outside source. This isn't just you making it up with your brain. You have to actually do the research. Your concrete details come from other places, outside sources. A paraphrase is one form of a concrete detail. Again, another could be a quote. But paraphrasing is not the same thing as summarizing. Summarizing might take 10 sentences and put all the main idea of that 10 sentences into one single sentence that kind of sums it up. That's a summary. A paraphrase might take 10 sentences and turn it into eight sentences where I'm just rewording all of the details in that original text. So a paraphrase is the act of rewording another author's words. Again, paraphrasing provides more details than a summary. One thing you should do when paraphrasing is start by reading it, then stop, think about what you read, put your actual original text to the side, and then reword it. Otherwise, you might be accidentally tempted to take more words from the original source than what would be appropriate. Okay? An in-text citation, again, I hope you know what this is by now, but an in-text citation is a written acknowledgement within the body of writing of where the source material came from. Okay, your in-text citation should include the author's last name, as long as it's available, and a page number, again, if it's available. If neither are available, or one or the other isn't, or especially the author, if the author is not available, then provide the title of the article, not the publisher, not the book title, but the title of the article, not the website, but the title of the article. Okay, this is also called a parenthetical citation because it goes in parentheses, right? To analyze in the context of writing a research paper is to closely examine to understand better or to draw conclusions. Okay. This is where you break down your evidence and discuss why it ultimately supports your claim. You might, in your analysis, in your discussion, you might use little bits and pieces of the initial quote that you're talking about in order to kind of tie all of the pieces together. Okay. Commentary is when you explain the usefulness of a concrete detail. So here's an example. Dr. Medina identifies that one of the major frustrations with cancer research is that cancer is not a single disease. Even cancers arising from the same cell type can be different. Here's the commentary. This can make it really difficult to pinpoint a cure. Instead of searching for a cure for one disease, researchers are struggling to find multiple solutions to multiple problems. I'm talking about why the information I'm talking about is important or useful, okay? A transition is a statement that is made between ideas or paragraphs that identifies the claim you have made and kind of leads into the claim you're about to make. So not only do uniforms cost less than buying a full wardrobe, but they also increase a student's positive self-image or something like that. Okay? Transitions are used to bridge the gap between pieces of evidence or between ideas. And that's going to do it for today.